In 2020, a group of fanboys that love all things pop culture have been accused of murdering a podcast that they did not commit. These fanboys escaped and now are hiding during a pandemic to lay low. Today, still wanted by the fandoms, they survive as fanboys of Forging. If you are a fanboy or a fangirl and you have a problem, then you need the F-Team. With your hosts, the Jack Nerd, the Jerky Man, Lieutenant Dan, and of course, Starpool. Welcome to the F-Team Podcast.
Hey, what's up, everybody? The Jack Nerd here, bringing another special meaning that it being the month of March, we had some birthdays, we also had St. Patrick's Day, we have a guest tonight, so just go around the square screen of the nerd dumb. We'll start with Mr. Chris Welty. How are you, buddy, and what did you get this month?
Oh, I am... dandy, just dandy.
Oh boy.
Yeah, I'm done for today for sure. But good news is I got a pizza for dinner on the way. Pizza's always good. Always makes the world go round. And for this month, I didn't really get a whole lot, except Dan got me something for my birthday. He got me a Xenomorph action figure from Aliens, and then he got me an action figure from The Tick, still in the package, still carded. And then I did get, like, the retro
collection. Don't forget that vibrating dildo.
Oh, yeah, that was great. That fixed my back up real good. Thanks, man. and then I got the retro style Darth Vader earlier this week in the mail.
Nice.
Other than that, that's pretty much it. Not a whole lot.
Have you, did you encounter any delays at all with when it came to shipping stuff to your house, or did everything okay?
Past couple of months, it varies. It depends on like who you're buying from on eBay or online, or I mean, Amazon, you'll get it no matter what. Yeah, in 2 days, 3 days. I mean, they'll have that shit out like crazy. But, like, a lot of the stuff I got earlier this month and towards the end of last month, I got a bunch of stuff on eBay, and that always varied. I get it, like, anywhere between 2 days to, like, God, I mean, say almost 4 weeks, because it took that long. Yeah.
It's funny because... John and I were talking last night because I met John through a Facebook group. I sold him some Transformers, right? And I'm from Canada, by the way. And normally it takes anywhere between 4 days a week. But for some reason, out of the 40 some odd packages that I sent out, John's was the package that got stuck. So it took him almost a month to get it, and it was really frustrating. That's why I asked, since you were getting stuff delivered to you, like, you know, from all these places, right? So.
I did buy, I think it was like a late 80s, no, it was like an early 90s G.I. Joe figure from a collector in Canada. It came right outside Toronto, and I didn't get that till like I think it was almost like 6 weeks in the mail.
So, oh my God. I find that after I ship stuff to you guys, well, by the way, a lot of my loyal customers, quote unquote, are from the States. Whenever I track it, it always, for some reason, gets stuck in Chicago. There's a distribution center in Chicago where all of these packages from up north goes through. And for some reason, I don't know what it is, that's the spot where it always gets stuck.
It's probably customs, I bet. I remember the one time I ordered a Masterpiece. It was a KO, but it was a Masterpiece Soundwave with all of his cassettes. I ordered that from China, and that took like... God, that one almost took like 7 weeks to get. And I went to the post office and I said, well, what's going on? And they said, well, it's in customs. They're scanning everything because at the time, I mean, I'm sure they're still looking around for it. But at the time, fentanyl coming from China and elsewhere was big in the news.
Yeah.
And they were thinking maybe he ordered fentanyl. I'm like, yeah. Oh, yes, that is exactly what I did, and it's stuck in Soundwave's ass. Yes, that is exactly what it is.
That's great.
But then, like, I think it was literally like a couple days later, I got it in the mail, because the tracking system also varies. So, it is what it is, I guess. It'll be fine.
Yeah, that's good.
What part of Canada are you from? Or in?
I'm originally from Toronto, but... Nice. Imagine Toronto compared to, like, say, New York, right? It's like one big province, we call it, up here.
Yeah.
And it's really big. So, like I said, very similar to New York. Originally from Toronto. And I moved out into, like, maybe an hour away, but it's still, like, Ontario.
Okay.
Yeah. So, my family's from Toronto. I live an hour away from the capital.
Nice.
It's called Brantford, Ontario. That's where I'm from.
Okay, well, that's nice. Right.
Yeah.
So. Oh, shit. John, we got to go up north. We got to get that weed.
It's legal here, guys.
I know. We're falling so far behind. God damn it.
Yeah, but there are some states down south that where weed is legal, correct?
Yeah, I'm assuming. It's California, Colorado, there's a handful of others, but I can't remember the others. But the one time I went to Colorado on a vacation, it was really funny because the town I was in, there was a place called the Green Dragon, the tall grass. They all had kind of like funny names.
Yeah.
And you know, and sure enough, you see, I mean, not everyone there, but I saw at least one person that had the dreadlocks and smoking it up and just being really mellow. It was no big deal. It was fun. I love Colorado. It was great.
Like, you'd be really surprised now that weed is legal here in Canada. Like, before legalization, like, everybody was assuming that everybody would be walking around with a joint in their hands, right? But really, it's nothing like that. It really isn't. I mean, like, I'll smell, like, my neighbor one day if I ever go to the backyard, you know, he sparks up a joint, but really no big deal, right?
Like, you ever try and be like, hey, do you need some help with that? I had a bad day, too. You want some help?
Not only is it legal to sell here, you can actually grow it.
No shit.
Yeah, the government allows you up to 3 plants, if I'm not mistaken, for personal use. Personal use.
Well, but really, here in Wisconsin, in the county where John and I live, there's some farmers that used to do dairy. Well, now they're growing
pot.
Well, it's not the pot; it's the cannabis for the CBD oil.
Of course,
They grow it, and then they harvest it, and they send it off to get oil made up, and then the farmers sell the oil. Either they sell it themselves, or they sell it to someone else, and then that gets made into all kinds of stuff. I tried the CBD oil stuff for a while, and it works. It's pretty good.
Oh, it works. my brother-in-law, he's in the Canadian military, right? So long story short, he's got a lot of pains and aches in his body. And last summer, for some reason, because my diet is extremely bad, I ended up with gout. And my right foot was completely swollen, and I couldn't walk for about a month, right? So my brother-in-law sent me some CBD oil, like topical. So, you know, I wasn't a believer of it until I actually applied the CBD oil on my swollen right foot. And believe it or not, like within an hour, you feel the difference. You really do. So I'm a believer. I really am. Like as far as the medicinal part is concerned, you know? So
yeah. I mean, I remember the one time I was coming home from work, and I'll be honest, the guys and I, we were coming home, and I was sharing a bowl with them. I smoked some of it. I took like three, like, you know, big inhaling hits from it.
Yeah.
And right before I did that, my knee was sore from work, and I took those three hits. And by the time I got home and got to the top of the stairs, my aches and pains from the day were gone. I didn't have to take Tylenol or anything.
During that gout attack that I had last year, I was popping Tylenol 3s or 4s or 5s like they were M&Ms because it was that painful. Up until I started using the CBD oil, and the moment I started taking it, I'm not even like exaggerating this. The pain got progressively better. Well, it disappeared. It didn't quite disappear completely, but you definitely feel the difference, the pain relief. Right. Because it attacks inflammation from what I understand, right? So yeah. If you have anything inflamed in your body, you apply some kind of CBD to it, depending on what type, and it's supposed to alleviate the pain. And that's exactly what it was doing to me. So it was great. Like right now, to this day, I still have a bottle of it. I always have a bottle of it, like in the medicine cabinet, just in case. Nice. Because I'd rather take that than Tylenol or some kind of aspirin because, you know, the side effects, right?
Yeah.
Like with the oil, all you're doing is basically applying it like lotion and you're good.
Yeah. So, Dan, you look so unenthused right now.
Oh, I was doing floors up until now, so.
What are floors?
Like putting in new floors in the kitchen.
Oh, you're helping out your dad with that?
I'm forcing him to do it.
Hey, at least he wasn't doing really, shingle
he's
work.
Been just pushing it weeks out, so. I was like, hey, do it now.
At least you didn't have to do shingles on a roof. That shit sucks.
I don't think he want my fat ass up on a roof.
It's like, I'm going to learn about gravity real quick.
Pop up a seismic graph will pick me up on with an earthquake if I fall off.
Oh, my God. Yeah. Well, what happened to him? I don't know, but we're going to need more chalk.
There was an earthquake. A really tiny one.
Oh, my God. Wow, you just threw yourself under the bus.
Me?
God damn. Okay, we got to move on. What do we got? Who's next? What?
Dan, did you get anything new, or how are you doing?
New? Damn, I don't even remember. I only got one new game for the Super Nintendo. And then I just bought a cheap Amazon PS2 controller because the PS2 controllers are, you know, after years are gone crapped out. So there's no way of me fixing it. So.
Hey, Dan.
Yeah.
Did you ever find that robot, that toy robot you were telling me about?
God, no. I still couldn't find it.
No,
I still couldn't
figure it out either.
I could not figure it out.
What toy robot was it?
I don't know what the name of it was. I know it was like a squarish red robot. I believe it was from the 90s. I just don't remember what it was when I saw it there. It was like $200.
$200?
Yeah. Because it's vintage. I just don't... I don't know. I don't know if it's from a TV show. I tried Googling just...
Was it, still was it Power Rangers, Beetleborgs?
No, I don't think it's anything like Power Rangers, Wise, or Transformers, no.
Because if they're selling it for $200, it must be something significant then.
It has to be. It's just I looked it up and I still couldn't figure it out.
Okay.
But yeah, besides that, I don't really buy much. Bought two PS2. Oh yeah, I bought two PS2 games and that was it.
Okay. Nice. Nice.
Well, I used to do a lot of PS2 back in the day. A lot of it.
Same here.
I think I still have my PS2 system somewhere in the basement. Like growing up, like my brother and I, we were really big on video games because my parents, they both worked a lot, right? So basically, video games were our babysitters.
Nice.
Terrible. It's more like my dad, I remember my dad would buy us, he bought us a Sega Genesis from back in the day. And bought a couple games with it too, right? I think it was like Golden Axe and Altered Beast, like really, really old school.
Mm-hmm.
And he goes, okay, take this video game, hook it up to the TV, see you in 3 days. So me and my brother and I, all we did like 24/7, just play this Golden Axe and Altered Beast game till we finished it. Now we were really heavy into it, really, really heavy.
Nice.
And we never sold any of the systems. So going back like early 90s, we had like the Master System, the 8-bit Sega, we had the 8-bit Nintendo, Genesis, Sega CD, TurboGrafx, then you know, like the Sony PlayStations came in afterwards, and yeah, crazy.
I gotcha. All right, well, Crispin to go get his pizza, and then Dan just still looks enthused. I'd like to introduce our guest joining us all the way.
Hey, you're not used to me seeing my face, so this is how this is my natural look of, you know, just boredom.
I gotcha. Well, anyways, join us all the way from Canada, Mr. Mark Mendoza. How are you, and what did you get this month?
Sorry, what was that?
How are you, and did you get anything new this month?
Oh, sorry. Yeah, this month was kind of busy. I was able to pick up a set of Gigapower Dinobots from a local collector.
Nice.
Yeah, I'm a big Dinobot fan, so the goal was to get every single version that's out there, and Gigapower was the last one that I did not have in my collection because A, it's hard to get, B, it's really expensive, and C, it's just not a lot of them out there. And every time a collector would put it up for sale, you know, there's always a ridiculous price tag attached to it, right? Mm-hmm. So yeah, that was one of the biggest acquisitions I had this month was the Gigapower set. Like, that's why I was selling like crazy in all of these Facebook pages to raise the funds to get the Giga. Because, like I said, there's this local collector that was liquidating. And I went over to his house and I noticed that he had the set. So we decided on a price. I told him.
We lost it there, Mark.
Shit.
Yeah, we just lost him.
Oh, it must be a communication issue.
Yeah.
And cue the Spanish fleet. We are currently experiencing chemical symphony. You gonna try to read Adam?
Yeah, I'll try to.
And did everybody get the notes?
I got that.
Okay, I just want to make sure. Dude, I felt like
I'm still looking for that robot, so that's why I'm looking up.
You said up. Like a boner.
God, I wish the soundboard worked.
I know, what the fuck?
It works on my end, that's the thing. I can hear it on my headset, and it works fine on the voice recording or whatever. It's just for some reason, it's like, you can't hear it on your end for some reason.
But you can hear it in your headphones?
I can hear it on, well, yeah, because I have two different outputs. So one is to my headphones, and one's to the Odyssey, and to you guys.
There he is. Here's Dan.
Got back? Nice.
Yeah, we lost you there for a second. Yeah.
Can you guys see me now?
We can't see you, but we can hear you just fine.
Okay. Just let me go work on this real quick.
So we were talking about the Gigapower Dinobots.
Okay, here you go.
Okay.
I think I got it.
All right,
beautiful.
There we go.
Sorry about that, guys. I got choppy internet up here.
You're good.
So, yeah, going back to what we were talking about, Gigapower Dinobots, for some reason, I started to buy a whole bunch of He-Mans. I don't know why, but stupid Toys R Us, I walked into one day, and they had some He-Man Origins, and I remember watching the cartoon when I was young, right? I don't really collect He-Man, but for some reason, it brought back some nostalgia. And $400 later, here you go. And the last thing I want to do right now, to be completely honest, is fall into a rabbit hole.
Yeah.
But it's not looking good right now. No.
Oh, boy.
So, yeah, just the Gigapower Dinos and a bunch of He-Mans from Toys R Us.
Nice. Oh, that's
right. You guys still have Toys R Us up there.
Yes, we do. Oh, I heard they went back in the U.S., right?
Yeah, it's complicated down here, Mark, because it went bankrupt and it was gone. Then someone was going to buy it. Then that didn't work out. Then someone else came in and bought it. And they're trying to restart it. And they got, like, a store in New Jersey just near Manhattan and Brooklyn, and they were just about to start rolling things out more and more and start going out, you know, towards the East Coast here in the States. Yeah. And then COVID came along, and then I haven't heard any updates, so I don't know what else is going on.
I remember seeing that in the news about like how it went down the toilet, Toys R Us in the United States, but here in Canada they're still everywhere, like 100% operational.
Yeah, because it's owned by a different company in Canada. And then I still have the last thing I ever bought from Toys R Us back in 2018. I bought the Rick and Morty portal gun. And this was pretty much the very last thing. The Toys R Us in Madison. And now I saw a meme. It was the Toys R Us buildings, and then it was all the Spirit Halloween places that went in them.
Yeah.
And you go in there, and it's like a dead Jeffrey the Giraffe, but it's a skeleton.
That's great.
God, that's rough.
Nice. But
batteries are dead.
Yeah, that's pretty good haul there, Mark. I think we lost him again. Damn it.
Looks like we lost him again.
I pissed off the spirit of Jeffrey the Giraffe.
Yeah, you did.
That dumb joke. God damn, oh. Joe Tiger. Or Tiger Joe, whatever the fuck his name was.
There we go. Just a dog shitting behind me. That's fine.
I would love to see Dan
in a meeting with all of his video bosses meeting? At work, and he's got that background.
I wouldn't get shit done. Let me fit myself over here in the Brady Bunch. There we go.
Oh my god.
Jesus. There's a story.
Marsha, shut up, bitch.
Oh my god. Yeah. Excuse me.
What the heck is going on?
Are you gonna be able to keep... If need be, just when he comes back, just have him only do audio. Maybe that's.
Yeah. Maybe.
I'm assuming he's on his phone, yeah, so it might that. Be just losing yeah. connection.
Sometimes
that
Skype.
Way.
Sometimes Skype runs way better when it's just audio.
Yeah. Yep. What the hell do you want?
Looking right at his face. The fuck is it now?
Well, I guess while we're waiting for our guest, because I'll just do my rundown for the month.
What'd you get?
A lot. Too much than one man should. But in other words, it was a pretty good month. Some days were better than others, you know. You know how it is. But so recently, I just got the Studio Cell by yeah. So I got this giant.
It's a giant cock.
I got this guy, a couple of the figures. I
better not use that when Mark comes back.
Mafex Deadpool. Couple other oddities and figures here and there, nothing too.
So how is that third party Unicron? I mean, that thing is huge.
It's fucking money, dude. It is fucking. Look at that thing. It's beautiful. It is.
I mean, it does look better than HasLab.
It's a lot better than HasLab. It has the glowing green eyes. I mean, the posability on it is. I mean, it's so fucking good. It is awesome.
Mark, try.
I'm back, guys.
Just your video off, so it's okay. Just audio. Skype runs better that way sometimes.
Yeah, just run audio on your end, and if you ever want to show pictures of your collection, you can just send us photos on it through any group chat and stuff like that.
For sure.
Just do audio. We're probably just gonna go all audio then from here on out.
We're on audio right now.
What's that?
I'm going on audio right now.
Okay. All right. Now Dan is going to be the entertainment, I guess.
Yeah, he is.
Oh, my God.
How do I turn this off?
It's definitely something to behold, but it's a lot. I think it's a lot better than HasLab's. I remember Mark and I, we were talking about a little bit about it last night, and how I met Mark was through the group, and I bought his Make Toys Point Blank. It's a blue transformer. It's really cool, and I mean, it's definitely one of those. It's a good figure. I like it a lot, and I just want to say I appreciate it, Mark. You know.
Hey, no problem. I'm glad that you enjoy it.
Oh yeah, I like it. I like it a lot. But yeah, so let's get down to business, ladies and gentlemen. Let's get the show on the road. I'm glad we did our introductions. So first off, going through our notes. Does everyone have their notes opened?
Well, yeah.
Okay. So what's new in the news is that Daft Punk calls it quits after 28 years. Theories as to why they broke up and do you enjoy their music?
Daft Punk, I don't know if you guys remember, like I'm much older than you guys, but their first their first big hit was Around the World. This song called Around the World from like the early 90s.
Really?
Yeah. That's it's a techno beat. Techno beat.
Yeah, like that's true.
Yeah, that's one of their biggest.
It was that album. I remember, like, back in 2007, I was in Disney World, and they had the Planet Hollywood, where you went in there and you ate, and they had all the cool stuff around. And they were playing all kinds of music videos up along, like, the walls of the place and screens. And one of them was Around the World by Daft Punk. And that was the first time I had ever seen that video.
That was, like, the one big hit that put him on the map from back in the day. That's the only reason why I'm familiar with him, because of that song or that beat.
Yeah. And then years later they did that, they did the music for the Interstellar story. It was like one, it was basically like they did a bunch of songs from an album, and an animation studio in Japan put their songs on like a movie, a Japanese anime movie that they made, and there's no dialogue in the entire film. It's kind of cool. Like one Daft Punk song after another, because it helps tell the story in this film. I'll have to show it in the group chat. It's kind of a fun movie, and I think that movie and those songs can help them continue on. But you're right, techno beat and Around the World, you're right, that did put them on the map.
I wasn't even aware that they still continued to make beats and songs after Around the World, because I've never really heard of them since. Then again, you know, I listen to a different genre of music though, right?
Right.
Like early 90s, like kids like myself, we were heavy into techno and house music, like rave music, right? And then, you know, I progressed from there to, you know, typical rap, hip hop, reggae. That's probably why I lost touch with that genre. But yeah, I mean, they were one of the pioneers of techno music, I would say.
I mean, I never really listened to them much. I mean, I know they were in Tron Legacy.
Yep.
They had a little cameo in there, and they're doing their own little beats and stuff. I think it's like the only thing Daft Punk I ever really saw or listened to out of that movie.
That was a good movie, Tron Legacy.
Definitely.
Oh yeah, it was.
I would love to see him do a third one. The only question is when.
Well, I don't think they're putting any budgets out for any kind of blockbusters anytime soon because of COVID. I mean, there's really no point for any kind of studios right now to fund any projects, because they're not going to get any revenue back.
Right. Like
how these two. You know, I mean, there was like so many Marvel releases that was supposed to come out last year, but they postponed it because, you know, they're not going to get any revenue back, right?
So, right.
I'm hoping that changes, because Tron, like Tron 2 would be great.
Yep. And then, I think the last movie I saw was with my girlfriend. We went to see the new Tom and Jerry movie, which was pretty good. But I think the one movie that we're both looking very forward to see, and I think everyone knows is what I'm about to talk about, is Godzilla versus Kong. You know, I think probably most of us here are pretty excited for that, whether if you have the HBO Max streaming service or whatever. But I'm pretty sure it's a movie that probably mostly some people here would be looking very forward to seeing.
I like the trailer because there's a shot where King Kong, he's in the air and he's coming down on Godzilla.
Oh, yeah.
And he's got that hammer thing, and Godzilla is just on the ground, you know, shooting his lasers at him. And there's a shot where if you pause it, it looks like Godzilla is saying, "Shit, this usually works. What the fuck?" I mean, they really are going to beat the shit out of each other. Oh.
I can't wait. I cannot wait. It's going
to
be great.
I'm looking forward to it. Like, I'm a big sucker when it comes to movies like that.
Have you ever seen the 98 Godzilla movie? I posted a bad movie review for it on our Facebook page.
Oh my god, that movie is so bad.
I've seen it, but I don't remember much of it. I do remember the most recent Godzilla movie. It's the one where you know that villain from Batman, the Asian guy? I forget his name, but anyways, the latest release of Godzilla.
Mm-hmm.
I remember watching that. That was good. But the 90s release, I've seen it. I just don't remember much of it.
That was the only good thing that came from that movie.
It's a very forgettable movie, I feel
like.
Oh,
yeah.
I mean, yeah, whenever it's on, sometimes I just sit down and watch it, but I'm like thinking to myself, this isn't Godzilla. This is a cheap American knockoff, you know? It's like we're always saying to, like, you know, China or Japan, you know, when we get, like, knockoff figures, we're like, this is just a cheap Chinese knockoff or something like that. And then we're watching what they call it, Zilla, which was like, it's not, I wouldn't even call it Godzilla in the 98 film. And it's just like, this is a cheap American knockoff. You know, this has nothing on the legit Godzilla.
Yeah, that's true. I didn't realize in the beginning of that movie, one of the Godzilla attacks a ship. One of the people in that ship is one of the henchmen from Die Hard.
Really?
Yeah, I don't remember the guy's name, but he was in Die Hard. He played a henchman in Die Hard, and he played a henchman in The Last Action Hero.
Huh.
Isn't it funny when you watch movies? Like, there's always that one guy that's been in, like, 100 other movies as an extra or, like, you know, a 5-minute clip or whatever, and you don't know what his name is, but he's been in so many. You know the character Teabag in Prison Break?
Never
watched Prison Break?
No, I never saw that one.
Oh, okay. Never mind. But there's this character named Teabag. He plays a big role in that show. And to this day, I have no clue what his name is, but I've seen him in so many different movies playing little roles. So
yeah.
Anyways.
Yeah. Anyways. Yeah, and just to piggyback off of that, I know exactly what we're talking about. It was The Dark Knight Rises? That's the one with Joker, right? Or is it The Dark Knight with Joker?
I think it's just Dark Knight.
It was either Dark Knight or Dark Knight Rises, one of the two. But one of the characters, one of the bad guys or henchmen, is actually Christopher Judge, and he played in MacGyver. He had one episode with MacGyver, and he also was Teal'c in Stargate SG-1 for 10 seasons. So when I first saw that movie, I'm like, wait a second, I know who that is. You know, it just threw me off for a loop. And you really don't see that. You don't see that type of stuff very often when you all of a sudden you recognize a certain character in a movie like that. It just kind of was just like, whoa, I did not see that coming. But yeah,
it's The Dark Knight.
That was The Dark Knight. Okay.
Dark Knight.
Okay, gotcha. So moving right
along. Hanson. Hey, I'm gonna bounce real quick and eat some dinner, and then as soon as I'm done eating, I'll be right back. Okay.
All right. Well, do you want us to keep moving on, or?
Yeah, just keep moving on, and I'll catch up as soon as they get back. Okay.
All right. Sounds good. Sounds good.
I'll try not to be gone too long.
Yeah, you got it, bud. You got it.
All right, I'll be right back.
Yep. All right, moving right along here. Big Hero 6 will not be getting a live-action treatment for the MCU. I'm pretty sure Chris will know more about it. Maybe we'll have him come back and explain that. But, I mean, I saw Big Hero 6, and I thought it was a pretty good movie. I really don't think it needs a live-action movie, to be honest. You know, I mean,
not too familiar with the character, to be completely honest.
Yeah, I mean, all it is just like these kids became superheroes and they fought against a bad guy who was using was the kid's name like Hero, like H-I-R-O, and he had like these little Magnabots and stuff like that could create things using like a headset. then the villain gets it because, you know, he was trying to use it for something, and then the one kid's brother dies, and then what happens after that is then they're like, oh, we got to find this villain and stuff like that. We got to find him, kill him because he killed my brother or something like that. Because I guess something with stage. I don't remember all the details. It's been a while since I've seen that movie. But
Doesn't sound like it's movie worthy.
it's a Disney movie, actually, as a matter of fact. And then they have a robot named Baymax, and he just kind of he was built to be like a nurse robot. Oh,
Big Six. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Yes.
I really don't think it needs like a live action treatment. I feel like it needs a sequel. You know, because I mean, it was actually a pretty good movie. I'm not gonna lie.
I watched that with my little daughter. That's actually a pretty good movie for kids. I mean, I totally agree. They should make a part two.
Definitely.
But live action, I'm not sure.
Yeah. Dan, any feedback on that? Are you?
I've never seen it. No idea.
All right, maybe we'll bounce back on that when Chris gets back on. But moving right along here, a new board game of 1979's Alien comes out August 1st. Why are they making a game of a great movie? I mean, don't get me wrong. I mean, Aliens is a pretty good movie, but I don't get why they're making a video game. I mean,
it's a board game.
It's a board game.
See, my question is there anybody out there that are still playing board games?
This is true. Most people are playing video games nowadays.
Yes.
I mean, card games, they still exist. You know, people are going to still play card games because, you know, you get to sit down and play with people. Like, I'm probably after the show tonight, I'm going to sit down with everybody upstairs and start playing Cards Against Humanity because I have the game. So, I mean, people still play card games, but I don't know much about board games anymore.
Yeah, I find that really odd that they would make such a project.
Yeah, I mean, it's...
Put it out for sale, so I don't know.
I don't know either. I mean, it's...
Can you imagine anybody going out and purchasing this board game and actually playing it? You know, when you have digital media everywhere available to you.
Right. I completely agree. Yeah. All right. Anyways, moving right along here. Cinefex comes to an end. Cinefex magazine that features anything in the field of special effects and filmmaking releases their last issue for February 23rd of 2021 and closes its doors due to the pandemic's economic impact. I mean, I could see that happening because, I mean, even movie theaters are starting to go out of business, and anything that does with movies, I mean, I could see them of how they would really impact due to everything that's happened this year past during COVID. Chris, you back? I don't know. He might be on mute. Hello?
I'm pretty sure he's not back.
Okay. So, I don't know. Anyone have any feedback on that? What was that, Mark?
I apologize, guys. My internet is really choppy. So.
You're good.
I don't have anything to input on it.
Okay.
What was the topic again? So what was the question again? Sorry.
We're talking about Cinefex Comes to an End, which is a magazine that features anything in the field of special effects and filmmaking, released their last issue for February 23rd of 2021 and closes its doors due to the pandemic's economic impact.
Well, we have tons of Cineplex movie theaters here in Canada, mm-hmm. and ever since the pandemic happened, every single one of them closed. And yeah. I don't know how sustainable it is, their business model, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because, I mean, the last thing that everybody wants right now is to be a participant at a gathering, which is what Cineplex is.
Right.
So, I don't know. I mean, like, what's happening in the States right now? Are movie theaters still open, or are they closed?
Right now, I mean, the three of us live in Wisconsin and stuff, and our other guest, he lives in Texas. But for some of the movie theaters here, especially our capital, right now they're up to 50% capacity that could be in for a movie viewing.
Like, you yourself, given like what's going on right now, mm-hmm. like would you, movies, like, you know, a friend or a significant other or a family member, would you risk it?
I mean, they are going through, they're doing their spacing between the, they're doing their six feet apart and stuff like that. They're taking their precautions. They're sanitizing the seats and stuff like that.
So they have the protocols laid out, correct?
What's that?
They have all the protocols laid out for safety.
Exactly.
But at the same time, you're still confined in a small space for time, right? So, I mean, don't get me wrong. I love going to the movies, and I miss going to the movies.
Yeah.
Every time, you know, they announce like a Marvel or any kind of superhero movie for that matter, mm-hmm. you know, I'm always there. I'm always there the first week or the actual day of. But like, the world has changed now, unfortunately, and I don't know how Cineplex and companies such as, you know, any kind of movie company that facilitates going to the movie theaters and watching the movies that we love. I don't know how that's sustainable right now or in the near future. So. Right. I mean, the first, remember Wonder Woman when it came out? Wonder Woman 84, or like the very last one that came out.
Yeah.
We were actually looking forward to see that at the movie theaters on a big screen, right? But then the pandemic hit. And then mm-hmm. for the first time ever, I subscribed to a streaming service that had it when they released it, like on the day of. And I hate to say it, but I actually prefer watching it at home. I do. This, I mean,
true, yeah.
Don't get me wrong. The experience of going to the movies is amazing because, you know, you smell the popcorn. It's a night out, you know. But at the same time, nothing beats the comfort of your own home where your fridge 2 seconds, like 2 feet away, and you're sitting on your couch and it's nice and comfortable, right? So,
I completely agree, yeah.
Like, I'm thinking Cineplex and all of those companies, I mean, unless they do something drastic and come up with a new idea to adapt to, like, the environment that we have currently right now with COVID,
mm-hmm.
I think it's a dying business. It's going to be like Blockbuster. Maybe. I don't know. I hope not. But it seems like it's going that way.
I mean, and even with the streaming services like Disney Plus and HBO Max, just to name a couple, I mean, I think, you know, eventually that the movie theater will maybe one day will die out. It's just only a matter of time when that truly happens. And I think COVID putting a test to that theory is definitely going to drastically change things in the future. And then everything's just going to be all streaming. But you got to think, it's like, well, how are these people then supposed to be getting paid that are directing films when a lot of that money comes from, you know, the box office?
Oh, exactly. Well, it's like, remember how music transitioned from, like, us going to the music store and buying CDs of our favorite artists to basically, like, paying for a download? I mean, they survived.
I mean, you can buy like, what, even if you just like one song from an album, you can go on iTunes, just buy that song. You don't have to worry about buying the entire album nowadays. You just want one song, or even having YouTube and you have like a recording program. All you gotta do is record the song off YouTube. I mean,
see, it was never always like that. You know, back in the day, like, you actually had to physically go to the store, the music store, and buy the CD for
$19.99. Yep.
And really, all you wanted was maybe one or two songs out of that CD, but you're obligated to buy the whole thing if you wanted those two songs, right?
Right.
So maybe, just maybe, I mean, the music industry survived because they changed their business model, correct? So maybe the movie industry can do something similar. I don't know.
It's going to be a really weird, drastic change if they do that. Because, I mean, I love going to the theaters, too.
Same here, yeah.
Yeah, especially spending quality time with my girlfriend watching a flight. Like, when she and I went to see Tom and Jerry. And it was the first time being in a theater for almost a year, roughly, if you think about it. And we sat down there. It was just like, we were the only ones in the theater. And it was a great time. It was just us. And, you know, I mean, I know event. I mean, whatever happens to the movie industry and the theater industry, it's just going to be a huge, drastic change. And some people just don't want to pay for a streaming service, an extra streaming service on top of that. You know, I think that's another thing that you know, people will be kind of worried about, is paying more money for a streaming service. Like with Disney Plus, for example, they have their Premier Access. You're paying like almost $30 for watching a movie on Premier Access.
See, but the thing is, I mean, platforms such as that needs to be supported, because if it's not supported by people, by the people that watch their product, guess what? They're going to stop making product. Like, you know, like all of these movies that they pour millions, if not millions of dollars to complete. Mm-hmm. No, that's going to stop, because how are they going to get a return on their investment?
Right.
Subscribing. That's why, you know, like, the one part I hate about going to the movies is the price, right? You know, they're ripping you off of the popcorn and everything else.
Oh, definitely.
But you pay it anyways, because you want to support the movie that you're watching.
Right.
Because, you know, if there's no support there, guess what? I mean, these studios are going to stop making the Marvel.
Yeah. Yeah, I completely agree. Yeah. Yeah. And that's an unfortunate thing. I do not know what this one thing that we're about to discuss about unreleased Kenner Star Wars toy. I mean, we might. There's a couple of links that. Let's see here. We'll come back to that Kenner Star Wars toy, extremely rare. And I don't know what the concept model of the Rebel Blockade Runner escape pod. I mean, we'll have to wait for Chris to come back. I'm pretty sure he has photos of that and puts that to the chat room, and he could probably explain that better. But anyways, moving right along, we'll come back to that. Mystery Science Theater 3000. I think we lost Mark again. I think we did, yeah. We said that he left. I'm calling him again. But anyways, Mystery Science Theater 3000 brings a YouTube channel. So if you click the link, just go.
Okay, back on.
Hello.
Yeah, I'm here. Sorry about that, guys.
You're good. Yeah, we're just talking about the Mystery Theater 3000 makes a YouTube channel. I'm just gonna read a quick caption here. Loyal superfans of Mystery Science Theater 3000, take note. Another new destination for rifting from the classics MST3K cast has appeared on the web. Frank Conniff and Tracy Bulian, known affectionately to Mystery Science Theater 3000 geeks as the MADS, which is short for Mad Scientist, have taken their show, The Mads, are back on the web, establishing a new YouTube channel that will host their future movie rifting endeavors every second Tuesday at 8 p.m. ET. Conniff and Bailio, I can't pronounce that, will be presenting ticketed live streams on the site with viewers free to tune in from around the world. Meanwhile, previous rifting projects from the Mads will be added to the YouTube account over time for free viewing. I don't know much about Mr. Theater 3000, Mr. Science Theater 3000. I mean, I watched some of their stuff on Netflix. I think I watched one movie on there that we reviewed on there. I mean, for what they do for finding these different B movies and pair and just making fun of them is actually comical, because some of these movies that they host and talk about are just completely terrible.
I'm not too familiar with
Mystery Theater. With, yeah.
Yeah, with that platform. So.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't know too much. I mean, I only know very little. I don't know too much about it. But. Yeah. Chris, I don't know if he's back yet, but probably not. But anyways, moving right along. The Nightmare Before Christmas gets a sequel. I have never saw the first one.
I'll watch it.
I never really saw the first one, but
I'm a sucker for Christmas movies, so I'll watch it.
Yeah, I mean, I do like how they shot that movie. I saw a little bit of clips here and there, but The Nightmare Before Christmas is getting a sequel, and no, Pete Davidson is not involved. Disney Publishing has hired Sheer Aaron Shaw to pen a YA novel set after the 1993 film. The new story, which is currently untitled, is told from Sally's point of view and begins sometime after her first kiss with Jack Skellington on Spiral Hill, with the two now married. A new adventure begins for Sally when she accidentally sets a Halloween Town villain free. The villain puts Jack, Halloween Town, and the other holiday-themed towns in the film's universe, including at least one that fans have never seen before, is in danger. Huh. So by the sounds of it, this person is writing for a sequel to The Nightmare Before Christmas. Cool.
Yeah. Straight to DVD?
Probably. I wouldn't be surprised. You know, straight to DVD or Premier Access with Disney Plus.
Not too familiar with the original movie, but I'm a sucker for Christmas movies, so I'll probably watch it anyways if it ever becomes available.
Oh, definitely. Definitely. All right. Now we're getting into some Transformers news. And speaking of Transformers news, there's a little bit more Transformers. Dan, Chris, you back?
And I'm back.
You're back. Okay.
Where do we need to catch up with? What's going on?
We were doing the Mystery Science Theater 3000, Nightmare Before Christmas. We did not know. I don't know what these unreleased toys look like.
Okay. So did you guys cover the Big Hero 6 rumor?
Yes, we have. And
okay. What about the?
I don't see a live action movie out of that. And then we talked about the.
Just start from unreleased Kenner Star Wars.
Yeah.
Okay. So I came across this on Twitter. It's a unproduced Kenner Star Wars toy from the mid-80s, because the guys at Kenner were trying to find new ideas to keep producing Star Wars toys.
Mm-hmm.
It is a Tyler would love this. I was kind of bummed out that he's not. Okay, so this is a Rebel Blockade Runner, and you can put a figure in the cockpit, a figure in the back. It had gun turrets, landing legs. So to find...
This was from the 80s or the 90s?
This is like the mid-1980s.
Nice, nice, okay. Wow. Sorry, go ahead.
So, excuse me. So this would have made a great addition for, you know, a kid's, you know, toy box or something like that, because, I mean, they've made A-Wings, B-Wings, you know, a bunch of other Star Wars vehicles. I don't know why they just didn't say screw it and release this, because this would have been really cool to have. But, so there's that. So now, I'll catch up here. So the magazine called Cinefex, which basically a magazine that talks about special effects within the movie industry that went on from 1980 to 2021, they are going out of business. Part of it is because of COVID and probably some other issues. I don't know. But this was like one of the magazines you had to get at the time. It was Starlog, Cinefex, Fangoria, and I can't remember the other one, but like those four, like if you wanted to know how this stuff was done with movie making, special effects, or what was going on in the realm of pop culture, this was one of the magazines you had to check out and read about, because this was pre-internet, especially back then, that was pre-internet. Nice. So these are just some of the magazine covers I found online that I thought were really good. And then later this year, there is a Alien board game based on the movie from 1979 coming out this year. I'm definitely getting that for the Alien portion of my collection, because I'm a big fan of that movie. And am I caught up, or what else did I miss?
We talked about Mystery Science Theater, Nightmare Before Christmas. We're on the Transformers portion now.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. So, just a side note, I don't know if you guys heard about this, but before we get into more of the Transformers news, apparently that Transformers 7 is on a price budget of $200 million. Most of the movie will be... Well, now Mark's gone again. There he is.
There he goes.
We're getting into the Transformers portion here, Mark, and I just wanted to say a quick thing about the new Transformers movie that's going to be coming out next year. It's about a $200 million price tag. Most of the movie will be shot in Canada and Peru.
Really?
Yeah.
I wonder whereabouts in Canada.
I have no idea. So if more news and stuff gets sent out, maybe I don't know. Maybe you can hook us up some photos, and maybe you can. You know,
I definitely would. I definitely would. I've only witnessed one live shooting of a movie. Who's the video game person on this panel right now?
Dan.
Have you ever played Silent Hill?
No, I've heard of it.
Okay, so they made a movie called Silent Hill based on the video game, like, years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And that was shot 2 blocks away from my work.
Nice.
Because, here in, I live in Brantford, and it's a small city, about an hour away from Toronto. And, the downtown, they had to make it really, really gloomy, you know, and they did like a whole bunch of stuff to the downtown core. They made it look like a ghost town, and it stayed like that for like a good 2 months while they were shooting every single day. So that was the only thing that I've ever witnessed. And well, I hope if, Michael Bay and all of those Transformers guys come down here to do some shooting, I get to witness that too.
You know, I'm kind of the movie guy here. I know a lot of filming gets done in Canada because it's cheaper. And we talked about this one other time on our little podcast here. Is what drives me nuts is like there's episodes of The X-Files where it's supposed to take place in America. But most it it's definitely been filmed in Canada. Like British Canada, British Columbia, or just outside of Vancouver. Because it, I mean, don't get me wrong, I've got nothing against Canada. I think it's a great country. But there's an episode of The X-Files that drives me nuts every time I see it. The episode is supposed to take place down in Texas, but there's a shot where you see Agent Mulder running to a parking lot, and then behind him in the distance, you can see, you can just barely see mountains. I'm like, motherfucker, that's not Texas. Come on. That's like British Columbia, you know what, territory.
You know what's a straight giveaway? Like, I watch a lot of TV series, even movies, you know, that are supposed to be shot in the United States and not in Canada. But, like, to save money, like you guys mentioned, they go up here, right? So whenever there's a street scene, what always gives it away is the license plate.
Yeah.
For some reason, they always forget to edit the license plates. And it always says, you know, something Ontario, something Canada. That's always a giveaway. Like with the X-Files, they do it so often. There's a show called Suits that's shot in Toronto. But, you know, they're supposed to make it look like it's in the States, right? But every time they do a street shot, you could always see the license plates, and it says Canada on it. So,
Well, I mean, don't get me wrong. There's beautiful places in Canada that are great for, you know, filming something or even just going on a vacation, you know.
It's cold up here, guys. I'd rather be down south.
I prefer the cold, actually.
Not until you start living in the cold, man. Trust me. I hate the cold. You know, one day if I ever hit the lottery, I'm moving to Florida.
Oh, God, don't go down there because the air is made out of hot soup.
Is it really?
Oh, dude, the humidity.
You know what? I would take humidity over, like, you know, 10 feet of snow any day. It just gets really, really crazy up here when it comes to minus degree temperature and snow. I hate it. And then I see, you know, commercials on TV, like people in Florida, people in Texas, people in California, where it's like summer all year round. It's beautiful. Like I said, if I hit the lottery one day, I'm joining you guys down there.
Yeah, but just be prepared. If you do move to Florida, just be prepared. You're going to hear every single day, Florida man this, Florida man that. If you go to Google, take your birth date, and then after that you type in Florida man, I guarantee you you're going to find a headline about something that happened on your birthday in Florida. But here's the thing. It's going to be something absolutely crazy and hysterical. Like, the one I got was Florida man feeds meth to squirrels.
What?
And tries to outrun the cops.
That's crazy.
That's hilarious.
It's crazy.
But, yeah. So, John, is this supposed to be the next Transformers movie, right?
Yeah, apparently it's supposed to be Transformers 7, but, you know, I think a lot of us, I mean, I felt like Bumblebee was a straight up reboot, but apparently this is where they're going to start tying in some Beast Wars.
Is it Michael Bay or no?
No, it's not Michael Bay.
Thank God. I'm not a big fan. Don't get me wrong, I'll watch it, but as far as the storyline goes, he butchered it, to be honest. Like, you know, like, my opinion anyways. So
I'm kind of the same way. I'll still watch him, and to be honest, I still like him. But now my overall number one favorite, without a doubt, is Transformers Bumblebee.
Yeah, that was good. That was really good.
And speaking of, we have something related to that, but I'm going to let John take it over.
All right. Now we're getting into some... Okay. Transformers Bumblebee Optimus Prime from Hasbro and other third-party figures.
Every single one of these looks good.
These are the masterpiece movie Bumblebee figures. I do not know how I feel about the actual masterpiece. I just, something about it is just off. It's just not very appealing to me. But, you know, you look at these other releases like Toy World, for example, and what Toy Lab is supposed to be releasing, which has a much more flatbed deal for the, like, the where the trailer would attach to. I mean,
for me, I'm a G1 fanboy, mm-hmm. so any release of any figure that somewhat kind of resembles the original G1 character, mm-hmm. I'm in. That's just me, though.
Right, you know? Right. I mean, I'm just talking about, you know, I mean, don't get me wrong. I mean, I think Bumblebee Optimus is probably like one of the, because you know who it is when you first see it on the screen, like, that's Optimus Prime, you know? Yes. And, you know, I think we all can agree that we would love to see just a movie on Cybertron with that animation stuff where you could tell who is who.
But you're right, John. Now that I'm looking at the pictures, there is something off about them. There's something off about the design compared to the third-party designs that are out there. So
they're all different designs. One's the Toy World, Spire Scorpion. Then there's the 3A. The 3A is the actual, more of the dimensions. This would be the more accurate one because of the, it's based off of the design. So it's based off the 3D CAD files that they got, and they made that the 3A Optimus. And then you got, and of course, again, you got your KOs, like what? M Wizard, LS-13 Tactical Commander. Then you got some more of the KOs, like the Star Commander, which is the actual, the Takara Tomy Studio Series. But I'd have to find it. The Bumblebee Optimus.
I think the one that looks the best is, for me, I probably get like the Hasbro Takara Tomy or Hasbro Takara figure if you're on a budget. But if you got money to burn, excuse me, I would say get the Toy World one. The Toy World one looks the most accurate, and the color scheme looks pretty bright and vibrant.
See, the problem I see with this is it's like another rabbit hole.
Because, that's the thing, too, is like if you're on a budget and you want to keep it light, then you can go with what Hasbro's putting out.
Yeah.
True. Because I guarantee you, if and when the second movie comes out, we will be bombarded with so many toys, so many characters. The characters that don't even show in the movie itself. And I don't know if I can get into this. It's just, I don't know. Like I said, it's just another rabbit hole. And that's dangerous money-wise.
Oh, yeah, definitely. I mean, trying to get into the masterpiece of movie figures is definitely quite the rabbit hole. But I mean... For the Bumblebee Optimus, for what it is, I mean, there's a lot of different options that people could pick for a movie style of more G1-esque Optimus Prime.
Are you going to go? Would you go into this line, John?
I mean, I already got masterpiece movie figures. I got all five of the movie 07 Autobots, three of the 07 Decepticons. I have the MGM Bumblebee from the Bumblebee movie, but that's going to be replaced once the Transcraft Bumblebee gets here. That looks so much more accurate than the MPM. I mean, it's just so much more accurate. What they did, Hasbro took, they rushed on that figure. And when Transcraft, I should have just waited for the Transcraft to come out, honestly.
Interesting.
Yeah. I'll have to send some photos later of the MPM and the Transcraft.
I have a buddy that collects nothing but movie figures, mm-hmm. like the masterpiece versions of them, right? And I've seen them like firsthand in person, and the design is amazing. Don't get me wrong. I mean, the engineering, the design, everything, materials, all top notch.
Mm-hmm.
Problem is, like, to each his own, right? I mean,
yeah,
I just personally, I just could not get into the movie figures for some reason. Like, I'll buy everything and anything else. I just couldn't do the movie line for some reason. Maybe because the 2007 toy line that was based on the movie when they came out left such a bad taste in my mouth. I don't know. Maybe it's the Bayverse as a whole didn't really quite appeal to me. Mm-hmm. So I just couldn't invest into it. Couldn't invest into it.
Right.
So. All right, but well, like the materials, the design, the engineering, and all of that, it's top notch.
I gotcha. I get what you're saying. But moving right along here. So some new Transformers series are apparently in development. One is a Netflix-to-air Transformers BotBots animated series. And I don't know, I mean, BotBots was a line that was, what, during last night, I think, if I remember correctly, where it had these little condiments and hamburgers, laptops, all these different like oddities that turn into robots. And then, and Nickelodeon orders a Transformers animated comedy series based on Hasbro franchise. I don't know how they would do that, but I mean, I don't know, Chris.
You know what it is? If there's a toy line to be made out of it, they'll do it.
True.
Because every piece of media that comes out is always based on a toy line, especially with Transformers, you know?
Oh, so, yeah, they've been doing that since, like, late 70s, early 80s.
Like, I've even heard that even before they come up with a concept for, like, a show, the toys come first.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they've already had the toys designed and everything even before the concept for any kind of show comes up, so... And that's very true for Transformers.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't see them not doing it if they're going to make any money out of it. If they're going to make money out of it, right?
Right. Right. I completely agree.
I mean, that's a whole different demographic right there. Instead of like hitting collectors, they'll hit like little kids. Oh, you walk into like a Toys R Us here in Canada or a Target like down where you guys are at. And, you know, they have figures of characters from that show. Guess what? It's coming off the shelf.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, I think BotBots is supposed to be for like toddlers and little kids, you know. And I think the comedy series ones, I think that's supposed to be like, I don't know, maybe for like 5-year-olds up to like 12-year-olds, maybe. I don't know.
That's how they.
Yeah, I don't know the actual specific age demographic here, but that's after reading those. That's the impression I'm getting.
Yes,
yeah. They're probably looking for those two age groups.
That's how they plant the seed, guys.
Yep. But moving right on here. I'm going to add to this one, too, but, well, for one, they're making a Masterpiece Skids figure. Skids is not a very well-known character. Like, I feel like that he's just one character that kind of got really backbenched. I mean, he's a character that really no one knows until he came more of appearance in the IDW comics and stuff like that, of how tragic his backstory was. Then we have the green dildo that is of Revenge of the Fallen Skids.
Green dildo.
I mean, I have a
MP interpretation of skids, and that is the X-Trans. I mean, for what the design looks, I mean, it looks okay, but at the same time, I don't know how I feel about it. I mean, there's already a colored version out there. I'm going to actually add that to this a little bit of this topic too. Let's see if I can find the article real quick.
What is that sound in the background?
What do you mean, like thudding or?
Yeah.
My banging. My damn niece and nephew.
You gotta get noise canceling headphones, dude.
Yeah, I know.
You got all that stimulus money there, boy. You gotta get on that shit.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah. Hey guys,
he already blew the stimmy on more Transformers, is my guess.
Yeah, that Unicron.
Over there in the States, how much did Biden give you guys for the stimulus?
For this new one, 14.
For the stimulus checks.
Yeah, it was $1,400.
It's $1,400? Is that monthly?
No.
No,
that's just one time.
That's one time payment for probably the next 8 months to
cover.
I guarantee you it's going to be 8 months or like at least a year until we get the next stim.
So is there like any kind of subsidy or relief financially that the government
if you're unemployed yeah. you get unemployment plus like an extra $400 or something a month.
So what's that total on a monthly basis if you were laid off due to COVID?
So it's 400, and then I forget how do they do like half of your pay, what your salary is, I think, or something like that.
Yeah, I think it's half your pay.
Yeah. So.
Okay.
That's the only, so pretty much if you're unemployed, you pretty much make as much as me, Chris, and John do.
Yeah, pretty much.
Working. Any. Yeah.
Look, because here in Canada, what happened? It's somewhat similar to what you guys are getting, I guess. It's $2,000 a month, well, Canadian. So that's about like what $1,650, $1,700 US, I guess.
Wait. So they've been giving you guys $2,000 a month?
Yes, it's $1,000. It's actually $1,100 biweekly. They give
Oh my god! Why the fuck did we just do that?
That's $600 a month, more or less, is what they give us. The government gives us.
Yeah, they give that to everybody, right? Not just if you're unemployed.
Well, if you were working before COVID and you made a minimum of $5,000, you qualify for $1,100 every 2 weeks.
Oh my god.
Hey, Chris.
Yeah.
Want to move to Canada?
That's Canadian, though, guys. That's not U.S. You got to subtract 25% or 26% off of that, right?
Yeah, that's true. But, goddamn, we should have started. I got. Jesus Christ. This is. Fuck.
Let's move to Canada.
Goddamn, America.
They also have. Yeah, Canada has free healthcare, too, don't they?
For the most part, it's free. Like, I'll give you an example. My dad had a quadruple bypass surgery on his heart 4 years ago. Mm-hmm. He got diagnosed 8 p.m. at night, Thursday, and they were able to put a team of surgeons and doctors together in 3 hours to do the procedure. And he stayed at the hospital for 2 weeks in a private room. And when we left, our bill was zero. And I asked one of the nurses, you know, I told her, Miss Nurse, if we were anywhere else but Canada and, you know, we had to pay for this procedure, how much?
It'd probably be like, I'm going to guess, $100,000 probably after insurance.
Try
more.
490. Yeah, 490. Almost almost $500,000.
Yeah, and that's probably after insurance covers a small chunk of it.
Yeah, if that. And we walked out with zero bill. So it's good that way.
Land of the free and
home of the debt.
The home of the debt. Yeah.
Unfortunately, yeah.
The home of pay for every single penny of anything you do.
I don't get
the taxes that we pay. It's crazy too, right?
I mean, but it's worth it though. It's worth it.
Well, unfortunately, not everybody has that viewpoint. You know, like for my family, of course it's worth it because like as it stands right now, we're indebted to the Canadian government for what they did to my father, right? So, but I mean, try telling that to somebody who's paying like 40% in taxes. So that's
Here's the thing. In France, they have universal health care. They have universal education, both for from 4K up to like 12th grade. And then they also have that for college and use it for university students. And then on top of that, they have universal child care.
That's beautiful.
And it's like that in a bunch of other European countries, too. And even though they paid up the wazoo with taxes for it, everyone agrees it's like one of the best things they ever have, especially if you're in France. Like, France is really good at that, and it makes sense. And people have said in America, like, well, if America has so much money and generates so much money, we can easily do it. We can easily afford it. And it would just make more sense.
There's a lot of politics involved in that, unfortunately. You know? I mean,
yeah, people get political about it, and it's like, oh, Jesus Christ.
Like, tax rates are so personal. You know? So personal. Every time the discussion comes up with, you know, tax brackets, it's always how do you say? It's always a sensitive topic, you know? Like,
right.
Like, for me, like, after what happened to my father, like, before the surgery, like, I would always complain about the tax rates that they would charge us on our income, right? Like, they tax everything here, like, property, income. You piss, you get taxed. You die, you get taxed, right? But after what happened to my dad and what the Canadian government did, they fronted the bill, right? Like, right now, whatever they tax me on my income, whatever they tax me on anything, I don't complain. I don't, because as far as I'm concerned, we're indebted. Like, my family is indebted. So,
yeah. So basically, like, when something happens, it's like, oh, okay, never mind. It's like, well, now we're talking. Okay.
But at the same time, like, what you guys have in the States, you guys have a lot of specialists. You know, so like with like people with conditions, like specific conditions, you guys have options over there. Over here, you're put on a waiting list. Like, you know, unless you're dying, like what happened to my dad, like it was either, you know, get this operation done within the next couple hours or you die, then, you know, they put you in front of the line, right? But if you have a condition that can wait, you'll be on that waiting list until you're almost dead. You know, in the States, there's so many specialists, you know, that can fix your problem right there and then. Unfortunately, here we don't have that option. That's the take back.
Yeah, I guess you're right. It is dependent. It depends on how you look at it. And, you know, it is what it is. But, you know, it does it suck because you got to pay for it through taxes? Yes. Is it worth it because if something happens to you, you're going to be taken care of?
Yes. Yeah.
And if you, whether it's a life or death situation, if they can take care of you right away, great. If it's something that, like you said, it's a condition and you can be put on a waiting list and be seen later, if it's something like that, okay. You know, so either way, it'll work out. The taxes suck? Of course. Is it worth it? Yes. But again, either way, it'll work out. It is what it is. And it's better than nothing, though. It really is.
Oh, it really is. I mean, that's why, remember earlier, I kind of mentioned that I would love to move to Florida. Don't get me wrong, I still have that plan. But the only thing that's stopping me from making that reality, if I ever do hit the lottery, is the healthcare. Because if
you something could go happens, to Cuba, they got really good healthcare.
I could.
Yeah, you could smoke all the cigars you want, and they'll still treat you for whatever ails you.
That's right.
Go down to Cuba, my friend.
You have a broken arm? Here's a cigar. This will help you.
Welcome to Cuba, my friend.
It's a proven method, you know. I don't know if you guys are aware. Break your arm, you smoke a cigar, you're well again.
And drive a really nice classic car, too, at the same time.
That's you're right. Bleeding out, here's a cigar.
Are you bleeding, my friend? Yeah, you're bleeding. Here's a cigar.
Oh, God.
Well, anyways, that was off topic. Sorry. Yeah.
It's all right. I think it's good for people to talk about that stuff just so everyone knows what's going on. It'll be all right. But anyways, John, where are we? Are we lost in space again?
We're still talking about the Masterpiece skits.
I want to pick this up, but I know I'm going to sound like an asshole when I say this. I'm just going to wait for the KO.
No, you know what? I support you 1,000%.
I like the KO.
But you could do what John and I did. Just get the X-Transbots version of Skids. Like, I'm looking at it right now. He's good. There's nothing wrong with him.
If, like, the X-Transbots goes on a price that I can work with, or if the Takara one is decently priced, then if it does, then
that's a big pick
it up. It depends.
Have you seen the prices of what new Takara releases are going for nowadays? Yeah, it's crazy. Dude. It's like over $200.
Well, John, how much was the Beast Wars Megatron when that first came out? How much was that?
God, I think about what? About two something, if I remember correctly?
Wasn't it like almost $280 or something?
I think it was less than that. It was around two something. I forgot.
I just remember people were bitching about that. They were bitching about the price, and they were bitching about as soon as they got it, there were some quality issues with, like, the crotch.
Yeah.
Something along those lines, and I thought, well, that's what you get. You know?
Yeah, exactly.
So you would have been better off a third party or the KOs.
Right, and I just wanted to add one thing. The link I did post is that apparently there might be a Masterpiece Skyfire in the works.
Oh, nice.
Like a Jetfire?
Yeah, like the Jetfire.
Like the fan stories, Skyfire, right?
Yeah.
The Jetfire.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah. Okay.
I mean, I don't know how I feel about it because I have the fan stories Phoenix.
Yeah. And
you have it too, right?
I do, yeah.
Yeah, and honestly, I think it's a great piece. I mean, the way it looks, cartoon accurate. The materials are solid. I mean, and with the reportage of breakage, I think what MP Hound had a lot of reports of breakages, including out in the doors. I don't know. And then look what they did to RC. I mean, they gave her fucking granny tits. I mean, cartoon accuracy works to some extent, but it's got to be done right. And how they've done it with RC, that wasn't done right. I mean, last time I saw her in the 86 movie, her tits wasn't hanging down to her past her fucking crotch, but I mean it's just questionable of the. I mean, and another thing, you know, why haven't we even seen the Masterpiece Jazz yet? I mean,
it's probably in the works.
Maybe after we're dead.
In the works, yeah. I mean, they're just everything's timing, right? So. One thing I do know, though, every time Takara releases a figure lately, like, the price point is always ridiculous.
Yeah, I think, what, the new MP Starter Scream is what? Almost
$300, I think.
Yeah, almost $300. And then I was thinking about getting it. I was like, I'm either going to wait for the, I mean, if I do get it, I'll get the KO.
Or you know, then I probably would sell my Make Toys Meteor to someone. I mean, it's a great Starscream figure. Then I found a guy on eBay who was selling a third party upgrade head, which had alternate faces and stuff like that. I don't know if I want to get rid of my Make Toys Meteor because the third party upgrade head I bought off is perfect.
See, the way I look at it, I'm the type of collector that does not play with their toys. Like when the box arrives at my house, I take it out of the box, pose it a little bit straight into a shelf, right? Mm-hmm. So if I have a good representation of a G1 character sitting on my shelf, I cannot justify spending more, double, triple of what I paid for that figure for a new release that comes from Takara or anybody else, because it's just going to do the same job, basically stand there and pose. Yeah, like really... The difference between like one design to another, especially if it's like super G1, it's very minimal. It's very, mm-hmm. very minimal. Like I hear a lot of reviewers, they would criticize like a body part. Oh, this is loose. Oh, that breaks. Oh, this isn't as articulated. But for me and the type of collector that I am, it's just going to stand on the shelf.
Right.
You know? Never going to play with it. So all of those issues that they bring up on the reviews, all the negative things that they bring up, more than likely, it'll probably never apply to me because it's sitting on a shelf looking right. pretty. And for me, like say that Starscream, right? I have Make Toys Meteor.
Yeah.
So basically the latest release of Starscream, right?
Mm-hmm.
As a masterpiece figure. So yeah. I'm looking at him right now. Reminds me of the cartoon. Very nostalgic. I think I paid like $200 for him when he came out. I'm not sure. Maybe a little bit less.
Mm-hmm.
And now Takara comes up with like a new version of Starscream, which truthfully, I've seen pictures of it. It's not that much more different than the one that I have. So why would I go through the trouble of spending more money and replacing like... the one that I have that perfectly does what it's supposed to do on a shelf,
mm-hmm.
you know, it just doesn't make any sense to me. For me, anyways, like I said, I'm one of those guys, you know, I take it out of the box, display. I don't play with it. So I can't justify the extra money. Like to me, if it looks good on a shelf and it brings back that nostalgic feeling of a G1 character from back when I was a kid watching TV, then he stays there. There's no need to replace them and spend more money. That's just me.
Yeah, it's completely understandable. I mean, we're all different collectors here. Like Chris, he doesn't have a lot of masterpiece or third party. I mean, he doesn't have a lot of masterpiece third party, but he does have some masterpiece third party. He's more of a Chug guy. Yeah. And then me, I'm more of the third party masterpiece ever. You know, I mean. I just think they are just really good representations of the characters. I like to fiddle with them. I mean, I like to get some good shots, some poses. I mean, if I'm not fiddling with them, they're back on the shelf. They are back on the shelf, and if I want to fiddle with one, I'll grab it, play with it a little bit, and then put it, and then I'll usually put it back. Or if I'm using it for a stop motion project, which, I've been really known to do that because I just feel like the posability is light years better than what the Chug has to offer. That's just my opinion. But there's some Chug out there that have really good articulation, really good posability, and then the ball joint is like is the most universal joint on a Transformers figure.
Yeah. But see, like you said, you know, everybody is a different type of collector, right? So mm-hmm. if it suits your need, then yes, by all means, go for it. But yeah, if it doesn't, you know, I mean it's a lot of money.
Yeah, it is. It is a lot of money. It is a lot of money. But I think at the same time, we do it just because, you know, like you said about the nostalgic feels. I feel like the reason why I collect is just that I feel that nostalgia of how, you know, when it was a much more innocent time than the time we grow, you know, it is nowadays. Like, that's why I still collect, but I gotta make sure, you know, a couple times I do have to
pump the brakes a little bit and just kind of take that subtle break, because I feel like I really don't need very much figures anymore. I mean, right now I have things going on in my life that needs more attention and more to be taken care of. But at the same time, I mean, I'm not getting out of the hobby. I'm just going to just kind of slow down.
It slowed down, yeah. Like, sometimes, you know, you have to put it behind life. Life goes first.
It's very right? true. Very, very true. Yep.
You know, like, right now, I'm at a point at my collection where I think I'm almost complete with everything that I want, because, like, it wasn't like, if I compare how I was, like, say, 4 years ago,
mm-hmm.
Like, I go on a website, I go on eBay, I go on all of these Transformers groups, mm-hmm. and there's, like, so many things that I want to get. There's so many things I want to get my hands on and own, right?
Right.
I think I've passed that point now. Like, right now, I'm very selective on what I add, what I purchase, because, like I said, I'm almost at that point where I pretty much have everything that I want, you know? But then again, you know, like I said, I totally completely understand. Like, everybody's a different type of collector. So, yeah. You know, you pick up whatever makes you happy.
Definitely.
Right? You pick up whatever makes you happy. So, that's right.
That's great. Moving on. So, apparently, a District 9 sequel is coming soon as District 10. Chris, you want to take over this one, or...?
Yes, so for those that saw the movie District 10 back in 2009, this is going to be a sequel that will take place at some point either right after the first one or at some point years after the first film. I know at one point in time there were talks about a prequel, but it looks like there's going to be a sequel instead that will hopefully conclude the events of the previous film. Or depending on how things play out, maybe it'll go into a third film. Or maybe this will just be like a District 9 and a District 10 and that'll be it. Or I don't know. But District 9, really good movie. You guys should check it out when you get a chance. And can't really think of anything else to say other than it's still in the works. But it's probably going to be a while because of the pandemic still going on.
See, we're missing out on so many movies that's supposed to come out.
Right? Especially the James Bond movie that they keep changing around.
Was there supposed to be one in the works?
Oh, it's done, but they're taking forever to release it. It's completely done.
Okay, I wasn't even aware that there was one that was already done already.
Yeah, so, like, it was supposed to come out a year ago.
Because I know, as far as movies that are being held back, the Black Widow movie was supposed to be done like by last year. It was supposed to be released last year. And they're holding off until, what, like this summer, I think?
Yep.
I think so.
Well, I know the James Bond movie was supposed to come out a year ago. Then they changed it to the summer. Then they changed it to, well, it's going to be released at some point in the fall. We don't know when. And then they were like, okay, we're going to release in November. And then they changed it again because their excuse was so stupid. It's so stupid. Their excuse was like, oh, well, we have to go back and reshoot a few things here and there because the product placement stuff for the current products at the time will be outdated. Like, you have all the previous James Bond movies and they did the product placement thing back then. So... it's outdated. Those are outdated now, but the brands are still relevant today. Like, how is that any different?
Yeah.
You know, that was what our buddy Jordan on a previous podcast was saying. And it was it's true. It's so stupid that I think what the problem is with that one is, it's always been tradition to release a James Bond movie in theaters. And I think, and because of the pandemic, it's making it hard for them to do that, but they should just say, screw it. we need to release the film. Release it in theaters and release it on streaming services.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
it doesn't have the same impact, though. That's the thing. I mean, to fund a James Bond movie, like how many hundreds of millions of dollars does a studio require to complete a project of such magnitude?
Right.
And, you know, now that we have COVID going on and the pandemic going on, how are they going to, you know, get a return on their investment when really, like, I think John and I spoke about this earlier, like a big chunk of the revenue that they're hoping to get is from the box office. Right. So, I mean, it's all about timing. They have the movie complete. Yeah. But really, with everything that's going on in the world, is it really wise to release it right now? I mean, remember, what was that movie that just came out? Tenet. Tenet is supposed to be a blockbuster, but it got released during a very bad time.
Mm-hmm.
And they did not reap the rewards that they were hoping to get from such a movie. From was a Michael Nolan, it was a Nolan movie, right? Wasn't it?
Yeah.
Tenet?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And like, what Nolan movie ever bombed? Like, you know, it's not in, like, Nolan movies don't bomb. And I've seen Tenet, and in my opinion, I enjoyed it, you know? And I truly believe that if the pandemic wasn't here and that was released in the movies, in the movie theaters, like, it would do amazingly well, you know? But they took a shot. Hey, you know what? Movie's done. We'll release it. That's what the public wants. And, you know, went down the toilet. They never got the return on the return on investment that they were hoping for.
Right.
So I think that's what's happening with James Bond right now, too, because that's like hundreds and millions of dollars that they have, like, you know, on that movie, that the studios have invested in that movie. And like through streaming, I don't know if that's a viable platform for them to make a profit. So I don't know. Just my opinion.
No, that's true. It's I understand they need to make the money back so the studio can pay all its actors and crew and everybody. And you know, they got to make the money back with what they spent on making the film. And then they got to,
like,
they'll make more money from the theaters and advertisements and whatnot. So they'll get even more money back.
So give me your opinion. If they were to release that James Bond movie right now, while this is going on in the world, how well do you think they'll do as far as revenue go?
I think it would, I think if they did it just right, I think they would make enough money to where they make all their money back, and then they make, say, like, I don't know. Maybe like another $30 million on top of that. So it would basically be like, okay, we did okay in the box office. We did okay. You know, they still got their money made back. Everyone got paid. They did a good job. The reviews were, you know, what they are, blah, blah, blah. I think it would work.
See, in order for, like, for example, if, say, the budget was $100 million, just a random number, say $100 million. In order for any movie or any project to be considered a success, they need to make three times that.
Right.
You can't just get the budget back. They need to make at least three times that to consider it a success, quote unquote. Yeah.
Right. So, I mean, it's,
I don't think that's possible right now. I really don't think so.
It's hard because I think it could, if they somehow do it right, it theoretically could work. But at the same time, then it's like, okay, there's still a chance this could blow up on us, you know? Because I don't think there's ever been a James Bond movie that was a total box office bomb, because they've all been pretty successful. But it, and I think that's the other thing too, is like, they want it to be successful you know, they want to do good, because it's all that too, I think, is like tradition with the Bond movies.
I agree. I totally agree.
And it's like, we could do it, but then there's still a good percentage of a chance that it'll blow up on our face.
That's probably why they're holding on to it.
You know, maybe,
you know, after all the vaccines are given out, you know, maybe all these restrictions will get lifted and people will start coming back and watch movies again at the movie theaters. Maybe that's what they're hoping for. That's why they're delaying it. Who knows?
Because John, isn't the same thing happening with the new Top Gun movie?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah, so even Tom Cruise with that is still... Yeah, that one's ready to go, and I think Tom Cruise is still working on the next Mission Impossible film, too.
Yep.
Crazy. So, we're missing out on all of these beautiful movies right here.
Yep.
Yeah. So I don't know. I guess just have to wait and see, and just see how it all plays out.
All right. Well, anyways, moving on. I know Chris is going to have a lovely time with this topic.
Oh, yeah, because I was madder than hell earlier this month about this.
Hasbro Kenner Ghostbusters asking people what they would like to see come back. So,
and they showed people online what they were going to release at the beginning of April, and I was not happy, and I'll explain why.
Yeah. Explain why, Chris.
Okay. Please. And this also counts for our segment Asshole of the Month or Asshole of the Week, because last year I bought on eBay an original Kenner Ghostbusters Echo One, and then I had to get a 3D printed replacement part for the top of it. And then along with that, the Echo One was missing the driver's side door, so I had to get a replacement on eBay for that with repo labels. But as soon as I got everything in the mail, I cleaned it all up. I gave it to Hanson. He painted it up for me, did a good job on it. And then I was able to get the reissue Ghostbusters figures based on the 80s cartoon last year. So I pretty much have all the main cast with Slimer and the Echo One, right? So the reissue figures are not original. They're just reissues. But the Echo One is mostly original from 1980s. But Hasbro had the balls to reissue the Echo One with the same accessories, color scheme, and gimmicks that the original one has.
Mm-hmm.
And the price for this reissue of the Echo One in the Kenner style for the Ghostbusters is only a mere $50. Mm-hmm. I was pissed because I had spent over $100 and some on the one I bought.
Is it identical?
The one I have... here's the thing. The one I have, the accessories on top of it are accurate with what you see in the movie. When it first came out in the 80s, it was the Echo One, but there was a gun turret and a seat on top of it based on the cartoon. And they're doing the exact same thing with this reissue. And... Ooh. The one I bought was missing the chair and the gunner turret on top of it. It was missing that piece. So that's why I had to get the 3D printed part that slides in, because it's more movie accurate.
I can see why that would upset you.
Yeah, because I spent over $100 on all of that because of... it was eBay prices. If I had known that Hasbro was going to re-release the Echo One as is, I would have set some money aside and I would have waited. I seriously would have waited.
Oof.
Yeah. I mean, it looks great, but I was still so salty about it.
I can totally understand. That happens in the Transformers world too.
Oh, definitely.
Oh, yeah.
More often than you think. More often than you think.
But I'm getting pictures of it right now, so I can put it in the group chat. But there's a Echo One reissue, and then there's a Ghost that was one of the popular Ghostbusters toys too that they're re-releasing. And then there's another one that was also popular where at first it looks like a toilet, but there's a button in the back of it. When you press it, the toilet lid turns into a mouth, and then there's a pair of eyes in the tank that go up.
Creepy.
Yeah. So I think those are supposed to be coming out in the first week of April. You can order, but the only places you can get them is either Walmart and Target.
How do you guys find Walmart and Target as far as inventory goes for stuff that you want to buy, toy-wise? Are the pegs always empty, or are they usually well-stocked?
Well, for Transformers, they're fucking empty right now. They're empty as fuck. It's ridiculous. It's getting all these fucking figures come out, and then all of a sudden it's just like, oh yeah, by the way, we're under stock. And then there, if you can get lucky at some Walmarts and stuff like that, you're like, oh wait, duh.
I see. Because here, like I said, I've been collecting He-Man. They came out with this He-Man Origins line. It's basically the same exact figures from what they released back in the 80s, but more articulated. But they look exactly the same. And the only places that carry them here is Walmart and Toys R Us, because they're exclusives, right? And every time I visit, nothing. Like, they never stock. They never, ever stock. It's always empty. You know, I thought maybe they do a better job over there in the States as far as stocking toys for, like, you know, collectors, I guess.
Nope.
Same deal, right?
Oh yeah. Anyways, moving on here. Custom Spylight, which is our we have a Decepticon Justice Division diorama by a limited number of Wives Customs. We actually know Chris and I actually know the customizer relatively well. He's a very, really gifted customizer. And I guess it's just a progress photo that of him building the diorama.
Looks nice.
There we go.
Wow.
Yeah, this guy that John and I know, he does custom Transformers, he does custom dioramas, displays, like every section of his collection, he displays his collection with a certain theme,
mm-hmm.
but there, like each like shelf or section of it is also a diorama. So he's got one for just Insecticons, he's got one just for Dinobots. So, and he'll do an environment diorama based on what Transformers they are. Or he's got some that are like scenes from the G1 series. And he's so goddamn gifted with this.
I'm looking at the pictures right now, and all I can say is, wow, that's pretty amazing.
I'll put in the link for his Facebook page, because you got to go and check out his work. I mean, shit is crazy.
I'd love to. I mean, that takes a lot of time, a lot of imagination, and a lot of skill. I can tell you that right now. Like, based on the pictures that I'm looking at right now, it's amazing.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
I wish I had that. They look like convenient pieces. They're great. Yeah, they're great. Does he sell these, or does he just make it for himself?
He's got a strict policy about that. He just makes it for himself.
I see.
Because he's got like he used to, him and some other guys I know, they used to do a podcast, and in one of the episodes of their podcast, he explained why he only does it for himself. I don't remember the exact reason why, but I'm going to put the link in the chat here, because this, oh, God damn, he's so, and the name of his Facebook page is a joke. It's supposed to be a joke because he had a really bad divorce years ago. So that's the other reason why it's called That's why it's called A Limited Number of Wives Customs. but if you go into, I mean, the pictures I put in the chat, if you think that's good, go to his Facebook page and just look up everything else he's done.
Oh, definitely. I'll definitely check that out
when you get a chance.
What kind of dioramas? Because they give your display a whole different dimension. It really does.
Oh, yeah.
You know, most of us, we just place it on shelves, right? Like IKEA shelves or what have you. And anytime I see like a diorama with like figures in it, I'm a big fan. I'm a big fan, especially when it's well done.
Yeah, because, well, his name is Chris Bishop, and he also has a full time job. Is like, he's also a graphic designer, and he's got like a printing shop.
Yeah.
So, and he makes pretty good money for himself out there. So during the weekends, over the years, he's always been working on this stuff.
Limited number of wives customs. Like
that. Well, I'll show you just 4 more images of stuff he's made. But when you get a chance, I'll let you look for yourself. You'll be pretty amazed with what he's done.
I'd love to. I definitely will do that later
on. Because this dude is, he's like a mad scientist almost. I mean, he really is. I mean, look at that.
Let's see. Oh, wow. Okay.
He's done all of that from scratch.
That's the arc. Oh, my God.
I know. Look at that shit. Isn't that insane? Jesus Christ. Isn't that insane?
That's stupid nice, man. Oh, my. I'm surprised he hasn't decided to put these up for sale. I mean, you'd have collectors going nuts over this.
Oh, God.
I'm not even exaggerating. This is probably by far the best diorama I've ever seen for the Ark. That's crazy. And this is just one of, Jesus Christ, he's got more. Oh, yeah.
Well, he's done scenes from various G1 episodes too. Because if you've seen that and you look at the dioramas, it's like, oh, I know what that is, or what scene that's supposed to be.
Yeah, I'm curious to know how long it takes him to do a project of this.
I think he's been working on this since like 2014.
Wow,
I know, right, dude? He's a fucking machine with this.
Oh, yeah. Love it. Love it, love it, love it.
Yeah. So, yeah, he once again got featured in our custom spotlight.
Hell yeah.
Does he ever go on your podcast, this guy?
We haven't had him on yet. We definitely will have to talk to Bishop sometime and have him on. What do you think, Chris?
Yeah, I think one of us should ask him, because I'm sure he'd be fine with it, because we probably spend most of the time just talking about all the shit he's done. Well, it's not just dioramas he's made. He's made custom Transformers.
Yeah, he's like literally fucking just made so much different Generation 1 obscure characters even. I mean, he did Illegal 1. What's that?
Does he 3D print them?
You know, he freaking uses, like, KO, scratch parts and pieces, Legos,
He'll even use like styrene, cardboard, paper, you know. I mean, the guy's a fucking nut.
Well, good ideas.
Well, there was the 1 year at I think it was TFCon. There was one of them where he entered in the Megatron Ratchet hybrid based on one of the original comic book covers. And I think he actually took two figures and a bunch of styrene, painted it up, and it looked pretty accurate with the comic book cover. Yeah, and he got an award for it, too.
Nice.
Yeah. And
you should get him on your podcast. Seriously.
I know. We're probably going to have to.
Okay, yeah, right. Just get him on your podcast and just let him speak his mind. I'd love to hear that. I'd love to hear what he has to say.
Want to try next month, Chris? Try to have him on?
Yeah, if you can get a hold of him, yeah, that'd be great.
I'll try to get a hold of him. If not, we just got to make sure we have a backup guest and backup guest somewhere, too.
Well, if we can't get a hold of Bishop for some reason, then I'll come up with a backup guest.
Okay, sounds good.
But yeah, we'll definitely have him on then if he's good for it, you know, if he's got the time for it.
Right.
Because his story was he even when he was a kid, growing up in the late 80s with the G1 toys, even when he was a kid, he noticed that they didn't look completely accurate with what he saw on the TV. So that's when it started for him.
Wow.
Yeah.
Huh.
How old is this guy? Is he an older person?
I think he's getting into his late 40s.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah.
I can relate.
He's already got like a couple of kids. So I think he's in his 40s.
Oh, yeah, have him on if you can.
Even did like custom, he did like a custom combiner of himself and his friends that merged into a combiner. And they call it Peter Tronus. And that was supposed to be, that was supposed to be the mascot for their podcast.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so he'll think of funny shit like that from time to time, too.
Super cool.
Definitely. All right. Back to Asshole of the Month.
Oh, yeah.
So apparently Ted Cruz for leaving Texans behind after a winter storm.
Man, fuck him. He's an asshole.
I mean,
what a piece of shit. And he throws his fuck. He'll just throw people under the bus and just act so mellow about it. God, he's such a piece of shit.
They're all politicians.
I know.
They're all like that. Like, we have something similar up here in Canada that just happened recently, too. He's called the premier, which is an equivalent to like a senator. Right. And he was supposed to be part of the COVID act, you know, quote unquote, basically, you know, tell people wear masks, you know, quarantine yourselves, you know, perform social distancing and all of that. Right. No travel. And right in the middle of it, you know, he gets caught taking a vacation to the Bahamas. And then he comes back. Sure enough, he got met at the Pearson International Airport in Toronto by like a bunch of media people, right? Like, hey, we just heard that you just came back from the Bahamas from your estate over there. Shouldn't you be like not traveling? I mean, you're the head of this COVID act. I mean, what happened there? I mean, that's kind of hypocritical, isn't it? So sure enough, he was asked to resign a day later, and he did.
Wow.
So we have people like that up here, too. Not just Ted Cruz. We have Ted Cruz's up here up here also.
We have a Canadian Ted Cruz.
Because it was all over the news here in Canada. He's like, how the fuck can you tell people to self-quarantine and follow all of these protocols? And then you yourself, right in the middle of the pandemic, go fly to freaking the Bahamas for, you know, a week-long vacation with your family at your villa.
Wow.
So, yeah, we have guys like that up here, too.
Wow. So, yeah. So Ted Cruz from Texas, he's an asshole for doing that because of that really nasty winter storm Texas had. And we'll just say the Canadian Ted Cruz, he's an asshole of the week, too, for doing that. And then, I don't know, I guess that's pretty much it. We don't have a whole lot for asshole of the week.
Yeah. So, moving on, we are about to enter the 13 questions with Mark Mendoza. So this is where you come in, Mark. We ask you our questions of what makes you a collector, you know, some other oddities and stuff like that. So to start off, what is your preferred name or nickname?
I just go by Mark. Like my full name is Ray Mark, so I just go by Mark.
Okay. It's my nice. Name. Nice. What year were you born?
1976. Probably old enough to be your dads, both of you guys.
Pretty much, yeah. What is your favorite food or meal?
I like ice cream.
You should come to Wisconsin.
Oh, yeah. I've heard about that. I mean, I remember when I first moved out of my parents' house, the first thing I did when I moved to my apartment was eat a tub of ice cream. Because I've always wanted to have ice cream. And I couldn't do that at my parents' house.
Nice. So what is your favorite color?
Car? I am actually a car guy. Two things that are my passion is cars and collectibles.
Now I was talking about favorite color.
A color. Yeah. Sorry.
Oh, good.
Red.
Red. Okay. Nice.
Yes.
Nice. And what is your favorite kind of music?
R&B and rap.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's more of a rock. I'm more of a hard rock metal type guy, but okay. Nice. And oldies are not bad, but, you know, it's just...
Oh, I love oldies, too.
Oh, yeah.
Remember when I was in high school, I had to commute with my dad to go to school every morning, and all he listened to was the oldies station. So I honestly know all the lyrics to every song ever made from, like, say, the late 50s to, like, the mid-70s.
Nice.
Only because that's all my dad listened to. Through those commutes to go to school every morning. I may not know what the titles are, but if an oldie tune was to come up, more than likely I know the lyrics to it.
Nice. Obviously, we already know what is your collection based on, or what kind is it?
The majority of my collection is made up of Transformers. G1s to masterpieces. I'm heavy into Robotech and Macross. It's like an 80s Japanese anime. Mm-hmm. Like I mentioned earlier, I started doing He-Man. I do a little bit of Thundercats. I have some Voltron. And yeah.
No but, Gundam?
Sorry?
No Gundam? Or is that another rabbit hole?
I tried to get into Gundam, but when I discovered the prices of the types of Gundam that appealed to me, I stopped right there.
Yeah, I mean, that's another rabbit hole. It's a fun rabbit hole, but at the same time, you jump into it, you know, you got to watch what you spend. But
like for me, I mean, I do it in such a way that the hobby pays for the hobby. Because right. I was to pay for this out of pocket, I would have been divorced a long time ago.
Right. So, no, I'm not even joking. I would have been divorced a long time ago. Wow. So over the years, like I've been collecting for 20 years, maybe a little bit over. So buy, sell, trade, buy, sell, trade, buy, sell, trade. If you do that properly enough times, like a big bulk of your collection would be free because the collection pays for itself, right? Like back in the day when eBay first started, like I would buy like lots of Transformers, for example. Like mm-hmm. say, when I say lots, I mean like 20 figures all in one, right?
Right.
So, no, I would pick and choose the ones that I want to keep. And the ones that I want to get rid of, I resell back. And 100% of the time back then, I would make my original investment back. And oh. it would actually give me some money on top of that after keeping the ones that I want to keep. Mm-hmm. So, like, you do that enough times, right? I mean, it pays for your collection. So whatever it is that I have right now, I would say, like, a good portion of it, like, at least 70% was paid off by sell trade.
Oh, nice.
Like I said, if I was to pay for this out of pocket, I would have been divorced a long time ago. I just divorced, but probably bankrupt too.
What got you into collecting?
Okay. So when I was a kid, I was born in the Philippines, and mm-hmm. It was my mom, my brother, and I back then, right? It was just three of us, and mm-hmm. We come from very humble means.
Right.
And I remember the school that we went to, it was an international school, so there was like a bunch of rich kids that went there.
Mm-hmm.
And one recess, I'll never forget this, there was a kid, they had a maid that comes in. Like during recess to bring him food. So after he eats, like the maid brings out like toys for him to play with before lunch is over, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I remember me and my brother was sitting like from a distance, and the maid pulled out a G1 Grimlock. I'll never forget this. And all of the other kids from the school gathered around and you know, like hoping to play with the toy or play with the kid or handle the toy or what have you. But my brother and I, we were like crazy shy back then. So we just watched from a distance. Right. I remember telling my brother, I go, you know, one day, I know we can't afford it right now because it's just me, you, and mom, you know. But one day, I promise you, not only will I have Grimlock, I'll have him and all of his buddies.
That's a good way of looking at it. That's kind of a fun way of looking at it.
Yeah, this was 5-year-old me talking. And you know what? That moment in time got tattooed in the back of my head. And to this day, I remember it vividly, exactly what happened. And that's what got me collecting.
That's awesome.
Like you could have said, like, okay, after school, we're going to run up and we're going to jack the hell out of him. We're going to take his shit and run.
We were way too shy. Like in the Philippines, it's a third world country, right? The Philippines. So, I mean, back then it was, like I said, it was just my mom, my brother and I, and it was either, okay, you eat or you buy toys. We don't have money for both. So we never bought toys. We just ate, right? Because you can't use food money for toy money because, you know, there's not enough. But when we came to Canada, you know, we grew up, we ended up having jobs and we did a little bit better and you know, you end up with some disposable income and, you know, you start buying things that you missed out on when you were a kid because we didn't have the means back then. So slowly, and, you know, the craziness happened.
I know exactly what you're talking about, Mark, because, you know, growing up, I mean, you know, I had to, growing up, especially in back in 04, you know, I had to wait for Christmases, birthdays. And then when I finally joined the military and stuff like that, joined active duty, I have this, you know, I mean, I was able to take care of my phone bills, my first, you know, when I first got my first vehicle, I was able to, you know, pay that off. But when I was able to have some disposable income, I just started buying a lot of Masterpiece stuff, like just starting to get into it. And then when I got MP10, I was like, man,
I was just astonished. Now I can afford these type of things that could be part of my collection. It's insane. You know, I never thought that I would have Studio Cell is my very first Unicron. I never got the Armada Unicron growing up. I didn't even bite the bullet for HasLabs.
Yeah.
Cell is the very first Unicron in my collection. And it just astonishes me still to this day I still have a little extra disposable income. I still take care of my phone, my rent, my vehicle insurance, the maintenance on my vehicle, and I still have just a little bit left over. But you know, now like we talked about earlier, it's about time for me to kind of like step back in the shadows for a little bit and build my savings account up, build my account up, so and then trying to
build your net worth.
What's that?
Build up your net worth.
Oh yeah, definitely, yeah, yeah.
Like, well, you guys are young. I'm telling you, Jesus Christ! Like, do everything it is that you have to do. Like, hustle as hard as you can, because when you get a little bit older, like my age, it's harder. There's not that much more opportunities unless you're already established. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Like, while you guys are in your mid-20s, early 30s, I mean, hustle hard. Hustle hard, because you won't be able to do the same exact thing when you're a little bit older. Like, opportunities, there's not that much more opportunities as you would like at your age group, right? So hustle hard, man. And that's what it's all about. I mean, you hustle hard, you play hard. I mean, what's the point of making all this money if you're not gonna do anything with it to make you happy, correct?
Exactly.
So, yep. That's my philosophy anyways.
You said hard.
All right. Do you have any other collections besides your May collections? And you kind of already hit that, but if you want to elaborate again, you can.
Say that again. What was the question?
Do you have any other collections besides your main collection?
I started collecting cards.
Cards.
Cars.
Nice.
I'm a car guy too, so okay. I started doing that. I have a couple right now that that are my babies, and they see rain, sleet, or snow, only sunlight.
Right.
So besides Transformers and action figures, yeah, I collect a couple cars.
Nice. All right, the next question is kind of, this kind of throws people for a loop, but we'll have Chris explain it, but I'll ask it anyway. Had you done anything untoward for your collection?
I don't quite follow.
So what that means is, like, when we say untoward is, like, have you ever done something, like, have you ever stolen money from a wallet to get a toy? Have you ever, done something you shouldn't have in order to get something for your collection? Like, have you ever done, like, a really nasty perverted act and gotten paid for it and then gotten a toy? You know what I mean? Like,
did you have to do nasty shit?
Yeah, what?
I have to say yes. Like, I joke around with a bunch of my coworkers whenever. Action. They say, who did you have to sleep with to buy this? I mean, who did you have to sell your manhood to buy this? I wish I can say yes to all of them, but no, I basically, like I said, buy sell trade over the years. That's how I try my best to get the hobby to pay for the hobby.
Nice.
That's how I do it.
Well, we've asked that story before, and we've usually get the earn it the honest, hardworking way. But I've heard that same question asked other people that I've listened to, and some of the stories were pretty good. But no one got hurt, though. That's the good thing. No one got hurt.
I would love to say, I sold my body to, like, a hot 30-year-old, to buy, like, say, the Dinobots that I picked up this month. I would love to tell people that story, but I know I'd be lying. And I wouldn't do a good job telling it.
I would have said, yeah, man, her name was Big Bertha. And, she needed it real good. But she bought me that brand new HasLab Unicron. It was worth it. I got a broken pelvis to prove it.
There you go. Yeah, unfortunately, the answer is no. Like it's all been done legitimately, unfortunately.
Oh, that's good. That's good.
That's awesome. What is your favorite and least favorite movie?
Okay. I don't know. I don't think I have a favorite movie. Scarface.
Okay.
Love Scarface. Yeah. As far as non-favorite movie, I don't know. I don't know if I have one.
Okay.
But as far as favorite, Scarface has got to be up there for me.
Oh, yeah.
The next question is, what kind of fears or phobias do you have?
In general?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. My grandma told me before she passed away that if you're born broke, it's not your fault. If you die broke, that's your fault.
Hmm.
And one of my biggest fears is dying broke. So while I'm alive, while I'm, you know, physically good, mentally good, like I told you guys earlier, hustle hard. Do everything in your power to establish yourself.
Yep.
You don't want to die broke. Because that would be your fault.
Good. Yeah. That's a very interesting. The next question is, what kind of car do you drive?
I have a couple.
Mm-hmm.
I have a Nissan 370Z. I have a BMW M3. I have a 1990 Volkswagen Corrado. And currently right now, because of winter, I drive a Jeep Wrangler 4-door.
Nice.
Nice.
Hey, is Dan still with us?
I have no idea.
Dan.
Yes, I'm here.
Oh, God, you're so quiet all of a sudden.
I'm just muted.
This whole time?
Yeah, you don't need to hear me breathe.
Well, we gotta know you're still alive. Hey, tell Mark about that nice Ford Mustang you got.
Mustangs are nice. They're very nice.
It's lovely. I like it.
Yeah, it is.
What year Mustang is it?
2010.
Oh, it's newer. No, I like those. Mustangs are good.
What do you call
5.0?
No, it's the 4.7.
Okay, it's still V8. Good.
It's like the last. Yeah, it's the last year they made it, the 4.7.
Tell me it's a manual.
Of course it is. It's not a it's not a muscle car if it's not a manual. Sorry. Sorry, no. Anybody that drives an automatic.
I was just trying to catch you, that's all.
So I guess the 87 Buick Grand National I want won't count because I think that's an automatic.
No. Grand Nationals they're on a separate category.
Super cool. Damn.
Super cool. If you can ever get your hands on one, that's the question, right?
Yeah, so that's true. Oh yeah.
I remember seeing them when I was in high school. They were all over the place, but now, Jesus Christ. Like just what they sell for, if you can find a decent one, it's crazy.
I just Googled the Volkswagen you mentioned earlier. It's the convertible, right?
No, it's a Corrado.
Oh, I put the wrong name on Corrado.
Corrado.
Let's see. I put the wrong name in. Oh, I've never seen one like that before.
they came out in the early 90s, like late 80s, early 90s. It's the very first car, production car, that came out with the spoiler that automatically goes up when you hit 60 kilometers an hour.
I've never seen one of these here in the States. Did they only release them in Canada and Europe?
No, they have them in the States. They do.
I've never heard of this model before.
See, the story behind that, when I was 16 and a half, that's when I got my driver's license, right? My grandmother bought me that car. She bought me a red one. She had it delivered to our house. And it was my very first real sports car. And I drove that for about 2 years, maybe three. Then my dad one day, he asked to borrow it because he wanted to feel young, right? So he drove it off a cliff. He fell asleep.
Oh, shit.
Yeah. Damn. So I received a phone call when I got home from work. It was my dad at the hospital. He told me what happened, right? First thing I asked was, how was my car? I didn't even ask him how he was. I loved it because my grandmother bought me that car, right? So I think I was, 19 when that happened? And I waited 20 years, maybe a little bit more, 25 years before I was able to buy another one that was exactly the same as the one that my grandmother bought. So I went to my brother's house in Toronto, and I pull in, right? And his neighbor saw me pull in my Nissan, and he's a car guy too. He's like, hey, nice Nissan, nice 370. So we started talking like on his driveway, and then I discovered that he was an importer-exporter from Japan. So, you know, we got to talking. I told him, yeah, like, you know, I like cars and this and that. But, you know, and he asked me, you know, what's the one car that you would want to get? Then, you know, the Corrado came up because, you know, I lost it when I was 19, right? Because my dad rolled it into a cliff, off a cliff. So he goes, I don't know if we get that, if Japan gets those cars, but, you know, if we ever come across one, you know, I'll let you know. He gave me his card, right? So exactly a month later, I get a text from the same guy. He's like, hey, when are you coming down to go see your brother? Because I got something to show you. So I went down that weekend. So what happened was his partner, who was in Japan, he FaceTimed us. And what they do is they import cars from Japan, right? They buy lots of cars and then they import it to Toronto, back into Canada. Right. They had a red 1990 Volkswagen Corrado that was identical to the one that my grandmother bought. So his partner in Japan was inside a warehouse where they just acquired like 10 vehicles, and one of them was the Corrado. He had like his camera, his iPad or whatever it was, just like, you know, like video streaming live so I can see the condition of the car. I was like, wow. So long story short,
wow.
I called the wife. I told her, hey, you know what? This is a once in a lifetime opportunity. I really want this because it's exactly like my baby. You know, I want my baby back. You know, I think it'll make me happy. And, you know, if I'm happy, I'm productive. Mm-hmm. It's like, okay, you know, come up with a number and we'll work it out. And 4 months later, it was on my driveway.
Nice. Wow.
That's, yeah. Awesome. So it's funny because when it got delivered to my house, I posted it on Facebook. And one picture was of me with the original car when I was 17. And the other picture was the new car being delivered on my driveway.
Nice.
Right. The only difference is one was the 17-year-old picture of me standing beside the car, and obviously the new one is a 43-year-old version of me standing to the identical car, which just got delivered from Japan.
Oh, that's pretty cool.
That's awesome.
Sorry to amble on about that, but
no, that's okay. That was a cool story.
Awesome.
No, it just surprises me because just when you think you've seen every single car model from a brand and you learn about a model you've never seen or heard about before, it's like, yeah, wow.
particular, that one particular model, they only made it 1990 to 1993, I believe. And then after that, it got discontinued because nobody bought it.
Wow. So would you say that's one of the best cars you've ever driven?
It's one of the shittiest cars I've ever driven. But I told my wife, if ever one day I die, please don't sell that car. If anything, find a cave with a big rock at the entranceway. Put me in the put me inside the Corrado and bury me in it. That's much because it was it's got history with me, right? It was like the very first car that I've ever owned when I was a teenager that my grandmother bought me. Like, mind you, it's not the same car, but it's identical. You know?
That's awesome.
God. Hey, Chris, awesome. remember the Dodge Neon I had?
Yeah, I do. No, I remember the one time you and Jake, you guys put a canoe on top of it.
Or when we packed like four of us in the car and then bottom out the suspension on the parking lot bumps.
Yeah. Yeah, I remember that. It was a nice looking car though.
Dodge Neons are not that bad as people say. Like, I know a lot of friends that drove Dodge Neons over the years, and, you know, they last. I think they even made an SRT version of it.
Yeah, there was. God, I had a 98 Dodge Stratus, and I'm telling you, that thing... I mean, yeah, I did the usual maintenance, you know, like an oil change and a tune-up, and I had to do some little things here and there, but other than that, It was literally a very reliable car. It was like a Toyota.
Yeah.
Nice.
I know.
The most reliable vehicle I've ever owned. You're going to laugh, but it was a Honda minivan. Yeah. I hated driving that thing because, well, when my daughter was born, I had no choice. I had to go buy a van, right?
Right.
And, you know, I got stuck with the uncool vehicle for a couple of years, you know, until she grew up a little. And I hated it. But in retrospect, when I think back, dude, it's like the best vehicle I've ever owned. I was able to haul anything in there, and it never broke.
So. I know. Honda makes some pretty nice stuff, too.
Reliable. I don't know about nice, but reliable.
Oh, yeah, it's reliable.
Yeah. All right, well... Final question is, do you attend Comic-Cons?
I used to. Then I stopped. Comic-Con, I used to go all the time here in Canada. But the purpose I had for going to Comic-Cons was to buy figures back then.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I never really bothered much for, like, the other events that comprised Comic-Con. Like, I was just in there for the dealer's room.
Mm-hmm.
And then at the beginning, it was fine. Like, you know, people were offering a lot of good deals on figures. Yeah. But then eventually it got to the point where, you know what? Their prices are the same as online prices, as retail prices. So what's the point of me paying admission? Actually, get that driving to the venue, paying for admission so I can pay retail for the figures and the dealer's rooms, when I can just sit at home and order online and pay the same exact money. So that's why I stopped going.
Gotcha. And that is it for the 13 questions.
Yay!
Made it through.
Made it through. So Chris has a discussion topic. I'm going to let him take over this one.
To be honest, I have do not recall that, by the way.
You don't remember this?
No. My memory is not that great.
Oh, come on.
I do not remember that.
You don't remember that? We were, like, just almost done with high school, and you told me all about this back then.
Yeah, that was what?
10 years ago
at this point. You really think I might remember?
Here's my recollection. You told me that this was like just probably just over a couple years after the Xbox 360 had just come out. One of the video games was Left 4 Dead. And there was a thing where you could play the campaign and play online multiplayer through the Xbox. And Dan, at one point, was playing the online multiplayer of Left 4 Dead. Well, apparently, he ended up playing Left 4 Dead with, like, a handful of other people that were all, like, in the same party online, and they were fucking flat out drunk.
God, I don't remember that.
I cannot believe you don't remember this. You told
me everything. My memory is garbage.
Dude, you told me they were slurring their words and cussing and saying ridiculous stuff, and they kept running into corners and running into each other.
It sounds familiar. I just don't remember it.
And you were telling me they were saying all this crazy, ridiculous stuff, and they're asking you weird questions. Told me they were drunk. They were drunk.
Oh, they probably were. Dead.
Oh, no, they were. They were, for sure. I just can't believe you don't remember that.
Do you remember any...
How about I ask you this? Do you remember any funny stories that you could tell us right now on the podcast? Do you have any funny stories from high school?
Oh my God. Funny stories from high school.
Yeah. Hey, no. Mark, you still there? Mark.
Hey.
Yeah. I just got your message. Just want to say, thanks for joining us. And, you have a very good night, and we definitely will have to catch up again some other time, all right?
Hey, it was my pleasure. It was a blast. I had a blast.
Thank you, guys. Mark, you got to get going?
Yep.
Yeah, I gotta do the late dinner thing with the family, unfortunately. I just got the wave from the wifey right now.
Oh, okay. That's all right.
It's all good. All right, you have a good night, Mark.
But thank you, guys. Thank you. Yep. We'll do it again.
Thank you. It was great having you.
Yep. You guys have a great night. Thank you.
Yep. Bye.
Goodbye.
All right, Dan.
I don't. Like, my memory from high school is just a blur. I hated high school, so I kind of just wipe it from my memory, to be honest.
Who is this? Is this Tyler?
I think it was Mark.
Oh.
I think I accidentally called the chat.
Oops.
Remember when we used to have the sleepover for birthday at my house? And then you thought of it was a smart idea to sleep on the floor instead of coming over to ask for a blanket or anything.
I didn't know what the fuck I was thinking. I don't know. I just remember you bringing out a mattress and you were giving me shit why I didn't ask for a mattress or a blanket. I was like, I don't know.
We wake up in the morning and he's like, oh, the floor sucked. It's like, what do you mean the floor sucked? It's like, I slept on the floor. I'm like, why the fuck do you sleep on the floor?
I probably woke up and thinking like, well, I don't want to wake him up now. I just, I don't know.
I think we were still awake. We weren't even asleep yet. I think you went to bed earlier than we did.
Well, do you remember when we were in seniors in high school, we had that graphics class with Sam Kaiser, and I don't know how we passed that class because half the time we were just fucking around and making jokes and shit.
Oh, that was a class that just... anybody could have passed that class.
Yeah, pretty much. Oh shit!
But yeah, I mean, my memory is bad for high school.
I cannot believe you don't remember some of this stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't remember much of high school either. Just very little bits and pieces.
It was a shithole, so.
After I picked up my girlfriend today, she's over here. I was talking to her. I was talking about basic training and AIT stories and stuff like that. It's funny. I remember everything in basic training and AIT, but I cannot seem to remember anything from high school.
Because high school sucked. The people that think they're popular freaking shun everyone else to make them low lives. So,
you know what's interesting now is that, like, back then they think they're all hot shit, and then you're like 10 years later, it's like, yeah, none of that shit matters anymore.
Yeah, you have four kids and can barely pay the bills.
Yeah, really.
And you know, I find it funny. It's like these the very popular people, they were at their peak in high school, you know, and then nowadays they're like,
it's just downhill.
What happened? Yeah, you know, like what the fuck happened to you guys? You know, you guys used to be so, you know, Mr. What happened to Mr. Popular over here, or whoever, whatnot? You know, it's just like high school sucked. Fucking hate it.
Yeah, college is way better.
Yeah, oh, yeah. College is way fucking better. I actually enjoyed college.
So, Dan, you're gonna try to send me that file, right?
Yep. I can send you it as soon as I stop it. I didn't know where you wanted to stop, so.
Chris, we good?
Good with what?
With the show? We pretty solid?
Oh... Yeah, I guess. Jeez.
What's up?
No, I was just kidding around. Yeah, I think we're good.
You need to speak more.
Well, I just want to say, you know, thanks to my co-host, and special thanks to our guest, Mark. Tyler was not able to be online tonight because he was sick.
He's got the COVIDs.
He got the butt flu. I tell you what, they're both shit. He got the butt flu from the meth in Iowa.
But
why the hell are you putting meth in your butthole?
Exactly. Because the heroin told me to do so.
Thanks to my co-host. Thanks to the guest. You guys take care, and we'll see you all next month.